Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Welcome to the show. Welcome to the podcast show here at 25 O'Clock. It's great to be with you all right now. I feel like it's only been 2 weeks since I did the last episode with John Vatese from the Key at XPM, which was a great episode, and you all responded very well to it. I was testing you. No, it was received very well. People really, really dug it, and I was glad to have met John. But it feels like a lot longer since I've put out an episode, and I don't know, maybe daylight savings time has something to do with it, although we'll all be blaming that for the next couple of weeks for all things going wrong. Be like, why did you crash your car? Daylight savings. Why did you short the market? Daylight savings, you know. Why did you let that nuclear reactor explode? You know, daylight savings. Let's hope it doesn't come to that. Anyway, welcome to the show. Welcome to 25 O'Clock. I'm Dan. I said that. Welcome. Welcome to the show. On the show this week, a gentleman named Marcus Harris, also known as MH the Verb. He's a rapper, an MC, a DJ, a man of all things, an art man. He's really, at his core, Marcus Harris is an artist. And he may personify that art as MH the Verb, and he may personify that art as a DJ or as a frontman of a live hip-hop band, but at his core, Marcus Harris is a soul out searching for art, for things that make him happy, for things that make other people happy, for ways that he can express himself, and for ways that he can work with other people and express himself with other people. I've known Marcus for quite a bit, not super well, one of those like friend of a friend type things. So it was really, really great to have him down here in the secret basement, have a chat. It was great. He was the first hip hop artist I think I've ever had on the show. And I'm a hip hop guy. I don't know too many of them. So again, I'm glad Marcus could be on the show. And I'm going to talk about Marcus a little bit more in just a minute. But first, I wanted to do a little bit of house cleaning and promo for other things. But first off, I just want to tell you about 25oclockpod.com. That's our website here at 25 O'Clock. You go there, you can check out old episodes. I got a big old archive right there for you. And you can check out links to pretty much everyone who's ever had anything to do with the show. So you finish this episode, you really dig Marcus Harris, like you should. And you think to yourself, man, that music you played of his was so great, I got to get more. Well, you can go to the Friends and Neighbors page on 25oclockpod.com and find links to all of Marcus's stuff and all the people who've been on the show before. So it's a swell site. We hope you like it. 25oclockpod.com. I also want to throw in a quick plug. I'm not getting paid for this. I don't even think they know I'm doing it. There's a podcast out there called The Great Albums. It's done by these guys. I think they're up in New Jersey. I think they're up near Princeton or Trenton or something like that. I don't know. I don't want to give away where they're from. They could be trying to keep it on the DL, keep a little secret bunker, much like we are here at 25 O'Clock. But there's this great podcast called The Great Albums. You can go check it out at greatalbums.libsyn.com. And it's these two guys. They have a guest on sometime, and they dissect and break apart, you know, kind of canonical albums of rock music. So they've like talked about The Replacements. A week ago, they talked about Dave Matthews Band, and I found myself listening to the entire program, and I'm not a huge Dave fan. I appreciate him, but I don't think I've ever listened to anything that long about Dave Matthews Band ever, and it was very, very cool. This week's episode is all about Notorious B.I.G., and again, they don't do a lot of hip-hop on the show either, so it's cool when they bring in someone who's a bit more of an expert on hip-hop than they are. But again, that podcast is called The Great Albums. You can check them out at greatalbums.libsyn.com. And that's my plug for them. I've been checking them out over the last month or two, and I've really, really been digging the show. I don't ring the bell, I don't toot the horn of too many podcasts out there. I don't listen to a ton of them, honestly, and that's nothing against the podcasts I don't listen to. I've got my few, and I listen to them, and that's just how it is. So when something like these guys at the Great Albums kind of comes across my consciousness and I dig it, I feel like I got to share something about it a little bit. But anyway, greatalbums.libsyn.com. Check them out. So back to Marcus Harris real quick, and then we're going to hear my conversation with Marcus. But I met Marcus, it's got to be back maybe 2010, maybe 2011. I can't remember. I was in an earlier incarnation of my band, and we had played a show. No, I knew Marcus as a friend of a friend. I worked with someone. She kept talking about her friend Marcus, who was a rapper, who was an MC, who was a DJ, and I had to check out his stuff. And one night I found myself at one of his shows, and I saw him, and I thought he was great. And then I found myself months later doing a show where he was in the audience for some reason, too. I don't even think he was playing that night. I think he had come to see my band or something like that. We vaguely knew each other. And we needed to fill some time at the end of the show. It was a bill that I put together. And so he comes up. My drummer starts playing behind him, and he turns to me. I was playing bass at the time and says, "Hey, do you know Rapper's Delight?" And I said, "Not really." And he says, "Oh, well, it just goes like this real quick," and kind of like sort of shows me very quickly how to play the bass line to Rapper's Delight, which I was obviously, I'm familiar with the song Rapper's Delight. And then we proceeded to do like a 15-minute version of Rapper's Delight up there with like Parliament teases and stuff like that. And it was a really great time. I will always remember that. It's this random guy kind of coming out of the audience. And sometimes, for those of you who've been in live bands and live situations, when that guy comes out of the audience and says, like, "No, man, let me get the mic," it can go one of two ways. It can either be outstanding because the person knows what they're doing and there's a reason they're asking for the mic, or it can be an absolute train wreck and it's like the worst mistake you made all night. You might as well have just turned everything off. That was not the case with Marcus coming on stage with my old band back in, again, it had to have been like 2010, 2011. And yeah, and then I didn't really see him or hear from him for a long time. He moved to New York and came back. In fact, when I approached him to be on the show, I thought he was still living in New York and traveling back and forth to Philly to play gigs. So I shot him a message saying, "Hey, next time you're in Philly, you know, hit me up and we'll try and set something up." And he said, "Yo, dude, I live here now. We can do it anytime you want." And so we did. And that's my story of kind of getting back in touch with Marcus Harris, MH the Verb. And from that story, we're going to go right into my conversation. It's a great one, and I'm going to play a track of his at the end. So, you know, stay around. Stay around for all of it. All the talking, and then the music, maybe some more talking. Anyway, stick around. Check out my conversation here with Marcus Harris on 25 O'Clock.
No, it's okay.
Yeah. Well, how'd you put your live band together?
So, you know, I started off doing live bands in Pittsburgh when I was there at University of Pittsburgh, and you know, I saw this band called the High Respects, and when I saw them, I kind of knew before then that I was always going to be into, you know, live instrumentation, especially, you know, I was in bands in high school very early on. I was in punk bands.
I was about to
bands.
Say you were like in rock bands and stuff like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. it's funny. I found some old recordings of high school bands, like recording old funk tunes and things like that. And it's great because I can't sing at all, but I was trying and I thought I was really good at the time. People thought I was good. So, you know, fake it till you make it. But
it's all about enthusiasm.
Yeah, but, you know, I really haven't had a band together consistently in a long time, you know, being a solo artist. And since the Beats and Verbs broke up, which was my college band, it's really been kind of like piecing it together depending on the area I'm in or where I'm at musically, what I'm working on, you know, giving different musicians in the studio, of course. And this is the first time in a long time, and that's part of the reason why I came back to Philadelphia, is because I knew that there were so many talented musicians here who I was already working with, kind of.
Yeah.
And I wanted to get them in a position where I could work with them consistently and then also perform with them consistently, so in and out of the studio. So, you know, the show that we did at Milk Boy the other day was really the culmination of about 6 months of work since I've moved back here, back here where we have been in the studio writing together. And we've also now done some shows together.
Yeah.
So it's kind of working out really, really well. And me kind of getting better at DJing and putting together live production. So, like, I'm doing a lot more with drum pads and drum machines. And
are you, like, doing sequencing live and stuff like that? Or you're hitting triggers live?
Doing triggers live.
Okay.
Not live sequencing or anything like that. That's the next step.
Are you playing anything live, or are you just kind of emceeing and rapping and doing your thing?
Emceeing and then, you know, doing the triggers.
Okay.
DJing. So I'm mixing tracks and, you know, cutting on the controllers.
Yeah.
And bringing in things and kind of orchestrating the band from the DJ booth.
Gotcha.
So it's kind of, you know, like a it's unlike anything I've really seen anyone do.
It sounds similar to like if you ever see like Massive Attack or something like that. You've got like,
I've heard of them, but I've never seen them.
It's a they're a British. Mm-hmm. They'd be right up your alley. I think you'd really dig them, especially since you're a rock guy and a reggae guy and all this stuff. Like, I think they would be right up your alley. They're from the late 80s, early 90s, from Bristol in England, kind of the same realm as like Portishead would come from them later. I think Tricky was like on the first Massive Attack. The Wild Bunch was like part of the Massive Attack collective or vice versa in the beginning.
I'm going to check that out.
Oh, it's great. Oh, I feel.
I'm always looking for new music, man.
I'm somewhat envious that you've never heard them before. You get to go hear them for the first time right now.
Well, I think I have heard them, but it's not like anything that is in my wheelhouse.
The
song,
you know, the opening song in the TV show House?
Yes.
That's Massive Attack. See, that's a song called Teardrop.
Yeah, see? I've heard of them. I've heard them probably, but, you know, I'm not the type of person who really listens to music and engulfs it in the sense of knowing every word or knowing the songs of bands. And, you know, I know the things I know about bands normally are the bands that I really like. I know albums.
Yeah.
I don't even know, like, I can't tell you track listings or songs.
I can't anymore either.
You know?
I don't think I've memorized, I don't remember any lyrics past probably like 2002.
And as a vocalist, I never have ever really, I've always mentally changed the words to lyrics. It's actually quite interesting.
Oh, what? To your own lyrics?
To everything. Yeah. Anything I hear. If I hear, you know, a Kanye West song, I change the, like, I write my own lyrics in my mind. I change the lyrics to what I want them to be.
That's funny.
Yeah. Justin Timberlake, you know, even the Beatles, I do that for sometimes. Like, and I think they're the greatest songwriters of all time. But I mean, like, it's just the way my mind works.
Yeah. So you're up there on stage and you've got like, so what's the lineup? You like drummer, bassist?
Right now it's drum, bass, keys, and me on DJ, and then some different vocalists that we have coming up. The next step is going to be to add guitar, and really the main thing is horns. I want horns. Yeah. A horn section would be great.
Oh yeah.
Working on it. It's a difficult thing to pull off.
And it can get really tricky, like
it does.
To like just amass that many people. And then
it does.
And then logistically, just get everyone in the room to rehearse, or like find a gig day that everyone can make and all that.
There's just nothing like having a three-piece or more horn section. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, we've done shows with a different saxophone or a trombone player, but having that three-piece sound is just electrifying.
Yeah, it's powerful, and there's more volume with it too. And it just sort of like, it punctuates the high end, and like you feel like a real band.
I feel like James Brown.
I was just about to say, you feel like James Brown or Parliament or something like that, where you're just like, there's like 19 people on stage.
Exactly, but the band goes, the band doubles in size just
as
by
the
that.
Night goes on. Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's like right now we have... primarily there's four of us. G.R. Stone, who's been writing a lot of the music with me, he's on keys. Evan Begonia, who also plays with Tectonic, he's on bass, and we met him at a jam session and just fell in love with his bass playing. I mean, like, the guy's smooth, very smooth. And then we have on drums a real veteran, Neil Simkin.
I know that name.
He's been around for years, man, and playing country, jazz, rock. I mean, the guy's a true veteran of the Philly scene.
And, yeah, I definitely know the name. I can't remember where I know him from. I don't know if I've met him or anything like that.
He's been around, and he's just a great, real chill dude who just is all professional. And so the three of those guys are holding it down. Mm-hmm. They pretty much... The way the set is kind of working out right now is I'm developing the songs through triggers and mixing, live mixing, and then they kind of come in to the song and blend the live instrumentation with my electronic sounds and kind of take it over, and then I do the vocals.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's a really interesting, because it's almost like on one hand you hear exactly what you hear on the radio or what you hear on the CD or the MP3 or whatever. And then all of a sudden, it's like live.
Yeah, like, it starts to breathe on its own. Yeah, it's got its own
and
organic
people are,
sound.
Exactly, and it just takes a whole new form, and they can kind of play with it. And you know, you hear the vocals over it. It's just people really have responded at Milk Boy, which was the first time that we did the full set that way. We actually ended up opening for friends Andy Fresco.
Okay,
Andy Fresco and the UN, who are dear friends from Los Angeles. They've been touring and they just released an album, and we did some shows with them last year. And when I was in New York, I did some shows with them. great guys, but they're really starting to take it to another level. And when they came in town, and Richard from Knitting Factory, who was managing them at the time, was like, "Yo, you know, you guys need to do the show with Andy at Milk Boy in Philly." I was like, "Great, we'll probably be ready to do a show by then." And it was a perfect mix.
It's good to have something to work for.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, okay, we have something on the calendar that I don't hate, and
you stick a pin in the calendar and be like, that guy's got to be done by then.
Yeah, you know, Milk Crate's a really chill venue, and we had a great time there, and they really set it off. Their band is truly electrifying and just very vibrant.
They're a great place too. I was just there this last weekend. I was seeing friends of mine play up there, and I was commenting to someone that like that place has been there like 5 years now.
Five or six years
in the city, not counting when they used to be out in the burbs, and they still have some stuff in the burbs.
Well, I don't even know what it was because it was something else.
I don't remember what it was either. I think it was close. Is what it was. A lot of that stretch down there, if you remember, even 10 years ago, was pretty desolate. A lot of closed retail.
Funny thing about being back in Philly. You know, I was in Pittsburgh, then I came here, and I did a solid 2 years here, mm-hmm. where I really felt like I broke the scene, you know, it was such a strong community, meeting so many different artists like yourself, and there was this whole, you know, I knew the places to play, and I wound up going to New York, and New York was great. I mean, I loved it, and I still love it. I'm there pretty much every week, and that's where I was this weekend. Yeah.
What brought you up to New York from here?
You know, it was the perfect storm of three things.
Oh, great.
You know, it was the first thing was a job, mm-hmm. An opportunity that I had through, I've been doing work in finance and financial education for the last 2 years. And I was working with a bank there, doing some personal consulting, and got an offer to go up there. And I had always kind of wanted to go back to New York. You know, I'm from there originally.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I have a lot of family there. So that was one, and then two was just music, obviously.
Mm-hmm. It is one of the two places in the country that are the big make or break places.
You know, once I had really made a footprint here, I was like, okay, what's next? Well, it's LA or New York, or abroad, I wasn't ready monetarily to go abroad, so New York was close enough. And really, the third reason was a girl.
I was about to say, if the third reason isn't a girl, I'm like, what's going on?
You know? Perfect storm, like I said. We broke up like a month later.
Oh, man. And then you're in New York.
Yeah, and I was in New York, and I was in my grandma's basement, and I was like, okay, well then, I guess I'm going on tour, you know? So that was actually when we did the 15-city tour that summer. And went all the way west to Omaha and Iowa and... Man, that was a summer.
Oh yeah, yeah. Let's take it back. Like, so you're mm-hmm. So you're from New York City originally?
Yeah, born and raised. Born and raised in Harlem, Bronx area.
Oh wow,
uptown.
So when you go back up there now, I imagine it's a completely different game than when like
I actually lived for the last couple of years right down the street from the apartment that I grew up in. Mm-hmm. I was there until I was about 4 years old, I think it was, or something like that, And so 145th and what is called Sugar Hill, it used to be called Sugar Hill, now it's called Hamilton Heights in Harlem.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You know, it's crazy because Harlem's so different.
Yeah.
It's so vastly different.
I didn't realize that's where Sugar Hill was, because I mean, I know the history from hip-hop, mm-hmm. and that's where the Sugar Hill gang was.
Well,
and
Sugar Hill, actually, you know, there's a little bit of discrepancy in that in terms of, it's actually the movie. The Wesley Snipes movie.
Oh, okay.
Sugar Hill is right there, 145th and Convent Avenue, and 145th and St. Nicholas. And I was on, I spent the last couple of years there, and, you know, now they got, like, hipster coffee shops. Yep. They got 7-Elevens and Starbucks and all these things that are just so different than the world I grew up in New York. And when I was young, I mean, I remember my mom taking me to the, you know, off the subway into the fish stores and seeing the homeless people sitting there and, you know, being on the train and it's just totally different vibe. You know, you got such a worldly vibe there now where it's a lot of, you know, educate people that work in and are there for Columbia education or international people, you know, a ton of influence for even in the black community from places like Africa and the West Indies. So, I mean, it's a totally different area. You know, Bill Clinton came in and changed the game, I guess you could say.
Oh, that's right.
I remember
that
was the big thing. Yeah. But I don't know, man. It's a positive and a negative.
I was about to say, do
time.
You have feelings on that?
Yeah, it's actually funny. I'm working on a song called Harlem Knows Blues, which is really just because I travel so much and I've been around so much. You know, I come from a family of movers. We've always kind of moved around. So I left New York when I was 8. And we went to Flint, Michigan, and then, you know, I spent some time in California and Montana, a little bit of everywhere, pretty much, and all over the country. And I finally settled for a little bit in Florida. My dad got a job down there in community. He works in community organizing. So, mm-hmm. you know, everybody asks him, I'm Army brat or something like that.
I was curious. I was thinking military or no, business or something like that.
I just like to say, you know, my parents are borderline hippies.
Oh, well, there you go.
No, I'm just kidding. No. But, no, realistically, they're just, you know, they come from a world where they wanted us to have different experiences. They weren't scared to move around. And so when we did that, we settled in West Palm Beach, Florida for a while where I went to art school, mm-hmm. but I've seen so many different communities, and one of the common things that I'm seeing right now, more so than ever, is just this whole concept of gentrification in areas like Harlem.
Yeah.
And, you know, where I'm living now, even in
Fishtown. Fishtown,
area.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's
definitely.
Crazy, man.
Yeah, the last time you were here, when you lived here 2-3 years ago,
Fishtown then.
Oh, yeah, I go up there now on the weekend. I'm just like, where am I?
Yeah.
And I've been going up there. I mean, I've lived in this city for, I don't know, 12 years, 13 mm-hmm. years at this point. And I remember you didn't even go to Fishtown. I remember when Johnny Brenna's was just a crappy corner bar that if you lived up there, you went to.
And now it's in the movies and Creed and blowing up. And
props to them for turning it into a great music room. And props to some of the businesses around there and guys who have always been there, guys like the Pinto. And for new guys like the Milk Crate Cafe guy mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. some of the restaurants up there. Well, but in general, every time I go up there, I just scratch my head. I'm just like, this can't all be sustainable.
Well, you know, it's it's funny because you mentioned like Milk Crate. That's the perfect example of... And Adam's a dear friend of mine, what he's done there is great. And he's the perfect example of when you see somebody who's invested in the community.
Yeah.
And you just
lived up there beforehand,
exactly.
too.
He's
it wasn't like
years.
It wasn't like he showed up from Chicago or New York and said, hey, let's open a used record store.
No, he's
store.
Been there for
yeah.
years.
Yeah.
And but that's why people like him are the reason that new people want to come there.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you have smart business people who've set up and created something really efficient and really special.
Mm-hmm.
And now in places like Harlem and Fishtown, and now you have people now coming in with all this new money
yeah.
and these new faces. And
it's like anything in music or art, like I think in punk rock or even in hip hop, where, you know, the authentic people started out. There's not a lot of money. You do it with your heart. You do it because you love it. Mm-hmm. And then somewhere along the line, once you finally broke through the wall of being like, all right, I think people are starting to pay attention. Some, for lack of a better term, carpetbagger comes in and says, like, well, we'll take it from here now. And you're just like, and I mean, I've seen it happen in punk rock. I've seen it happen seen and read of it happening in hip hop and all kinds of
it's
music.
Scary.
Yeah.
It's scary. It's exciting on some levels because, you know, you want to, yeah. You want to see the investments in
communities. Who doesn't want to get paid really in the end?
Well, but, yeah. And you want to, you know, when you have these companies who are coming in and these artists who are redeveloping these areas at first, you want to reward them with, you know, property value increases, with
yeah.
new businesses, with influx, but the communities themselves have to be very careful about
yeah.
this. And I don't think enough people are really aware of what's going on or really are engaged in the process politically.
Yeah.
And especially, you know, we talk so much in everybody's news feed, say, talk about Donald Trump and talk about the presidential races, yeah. national elections. But
there's local stuff, yeah.
Yeah, man, there's tons of local stuff that people need to get involved in their own communities.
Oh, yeah.
And so that's, you know, that's a big part of me coming back here. I wanted to be more in depth in a community, and I mm-hmm. chose Philadelphia to really get involved in, and I'm trying to, you know, do my part.
So you're moving around a lot as a kid, and your dad was a community organizer. Mm-hmm. What did your mom do?
She was a teacher. She started off as an accountant and became a teacher, and she, you know, kept us on the straight and narrow.
What did she teach?
She does elementary education now.
Oh, okay.
She's an administrator, so she, you know, she's done pretty much every grade, and she's, you know, in a different life. I think she might have been an artist in some forms. She's, you know, she's in some ways a comedian. She's a character in her own self.
Yeah.
But she's a very powerful person as well. When it comes to the ideas and creativity and different things. And, you know, it's a shame that neither one of my parents are musicians or actors, because they would have both been really great at it in some levels. I mean, my dad did things like photography and, you know, technology and different things like that. But I'm the sole lone musician.
Yeah, you got brothers, sisters?
Brother, he's in the Navy.
Older?
Younger.
Oh.
6 years. Yeah.
You couldn't bring him into the music world?
We couldn't be more different.
I'm sure that's great though. Like, no, I'm sure that's
it's you know, it's an interesting thing, cuz there's nobody in the world that I love more than my brother. He's in my, you know, he's my best friend. He's the person who I always think of.
Well, you traveled around together too. I imagine every time you went to a new place, you had your brother.
Well, we had you know, it's weird because a 6-year difference is an odd difference to have.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there's certain things that we mirror in each other that, you know, in experiences that we have that no one else has. Mm-hmm. And so that's what keeps us close. And he's a very, very different person than I am, obviously. My artistic levels are not really where he would like them to be in terms of, you know, my realism of reality and how I portray different situations and things. You know, he has different political views. Mm-hmm. He has different world views. But, you know, I couldn't be more proud of him, and I've learned so much about, you know, me being kind of a radical in some senses, but I've learned a lot about having someone who gets deployed, having someone who dedicates their life to saving the country and protecting us is something that is really, it's a whole different aspect of humble, of humility in terms of and pride. So, you know, I've really, my nationalism has actually increased. My idea of country and pride in government and pride in land and where, you know, being a United States citizen has really shifted a little bit over the last few years as he's done more and moved up and things like that. So,
well, it sounds like you're able to take his experiences and kind of put them into your own experiences and understand that, you know.
It's interesting because I'm actually, one of the songs that we're going to release soon is a song called Better Way. And the song, the first verse of the song spawned from a letter I wrote to him where it says, "Hey, little brother, so much to say in this letter. Last time we spoke, you sounded down. I hope you're feeling better." I mean, it's you know, it's conversations that we had over times kind of condensed into one verse, me sharing ideas, him not necessarily, you know, the give back. So I'm really excited to see that. It was a really personal project for me, and, you know, GR and I sat down and wrote it, and with the keys and really wrote it much more like a singer-songwriter would sit down and write, you know, taking a poem and transposing it into musical form.
Yeah, and that's the one thing I've always noticed about you from the little bit I knew about your music when I met you years ago was, and perhaps this is how a lot of other hip-hop artists put stuff together. I know it as a listener to a point. Mm-hmm. I've never been in a hip-hop group. I've never really worked with a hip-hop artist before. But the way you seemed to approach music a lot seemed not at all different from the way that any rock band that I'd ever worked on. I said, oh, he's got an idea. He sits down. He writes it on piano or guitar. And then he makes a bigger version of it.
You know, not always. I like to work with a lot of different musicians. So I think that's where it gets a little cloudy.
Yeah.
But really, I've never even considered myself a musician. I've always considered myself more of an artist. Multimedia and different, because I'm an idea guy. You know, I come up with these ideas, and it's not necessarily always poetry or lyrics. It's just, here's what I'm feeling. Here's what I see. Here's what people are talking about. And I want to tell that story. You know, I want to be a storyteller. I want to evoke that emotion in people and make them feel something. So a lot of times, you know, it does start with music. It does start with poetry. But even more so, I think it starts with a creative vision. Sometimes that's even visual, or, you know, I'm a very big fan, and I've worked with tons of painters and videographers and photographers, like, you know, like Crystal Engel, and just, you know, everything that you take in this world affects you differently, and everybody has a different perception. And so to explain your perception or allow somebody else to interject their perception into your views, into your creative process, that's the synergistic approach that I always take at things.
No,
so.
Absolutely. I don't think you can sit there and create stuff in your own vacuum. Well, I mean, you can, but you in the end, but in the end, you got to put it out in front of somebody.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
I think I think stuff gets a lot better when there's collaboration.
I agree. I mean, your vision is only you know, it's tunnel.
Yeah.
And the wider you make your space, you know, that's the whole idea of Balloon Up. So
yeah. Well, yeah, I definitely want to talk about that record too, because I really enjoy it, and I really enjoyed the all the just there's a ton of different elements in that, and I, but not in a mishmash way, not in a way where you kind of walk away being like, well, I'm not entirely sure what that guy's about. I think at the end of that, I think at the end of that record, it's very clear what you're about on that record. But there's so many things in there. I remember you floated this one track, I think when you were working on the record, where you had like that Harry Nilsson sample in there.
Yeah.
And I remember commenting, I said, I have never heard a hip hop song sample Harry Nilsson before.
Yeah, that one didn't even make the album.
No, it didn't. It didn't. But I just, I got such a kick
out of it.
You'll
hear it though this year.
Yeah, I got such a kick out of it. I was like, because I'm a huge Harry Nilsson.
Harry
fan.
Nilsson is a huge influence. Oh,
I'm a huge fan of his. He's huge
same,
for me too.
Same.
And for me to like hear him come up in hip hop to get sampled, I was like, well, that's different.
Well, I mean, you know, Harry Nilsson is somebody that he's his artistic views on songwriting and his approaches and things like that. His talent, just in general.
Yeah.
Is so unappreciated in terms of where we are in rock, popular music. His contribution is not to be forgotten. And unfortunately, you know, he came up in the time of
the Beatles. Yeah, the Beatles and the Stones and the Who and all that.
And I was going to say, what's the Randy Newman? And
oh,
so,
yeah.
So, you know.
He did a whole record of Randy Newman covers, and it's fantastic. It actually made me want to then get to delve into Randy Newman material a little more. I never really gave Randy Newman much thought, other than I knew that he was a great songwriter and like held in high regard. The great thing to me about Harry Nilsson was that he was almost all like just sheer raw talent and brilliance, but to his detriment, almost no business at all.
Yeah. I mean, when you look at Harry Nilsson's career, it's kind of an anomaly that somebody could be, because the guy didn't play shows.
No, he didn't tour.
He didn't tour. He didn't do shows.
He barely put, I mean, and the records he put out were like more and more like different than the other ones. You really
didn't want to be a star.
No, he just wanted to be a songwriter.
But he couldn't, exactly. And the thing that's amazing about it is that as much as he tried not to be a star, he was the quintessential star.
Yeah.
And, you know, rock star, you know, the lifestyle personified. Yeah. And just even the way he, you know, the successes that he had, he didn't want those. He didn't, you know, it wasn't like something.
The Nilsson Schmelson album?
Yeah, that album is amazing.
That is his calling card right there to the world. And like there's some records
he didn't even think it was that good.
I thought it was great, but
he didn't.
And then but he then spent the next two records of his career trying to undo the success that he got from Nilsson Schmelson. So if you listen to like Son of Schmelson or something like that, with like the weird dissonant screaming tracks and stuff like that, where he was like literally just being like, Well fuck you then. Like
And that album he did with the Pussycat album.
Yeah, with John Lennon, yeah.
I mean, watching the documentary of him was crazy.
Yeah.
Because to see, and I mean, the drugs did it a lot.
Yeah.
The drugs and the drinking did it a lot. But I mean, he really took his voice and really had no regard for it, especially later in his career.
Yeah, which is, that's the saddest part of all of it, is that like, I always thought like, you know, you can spurn fame, you can spurn success, you can spurn notoriety, all at that point, whether it comes or whether it doesn't. He was fortunate enough to be in a position where he could spurn it because it was coming to him.
Yes.
But to destroy like that primal personal instrument that is your voice, like to me, I was like, that was the most tragic part about him. I think more tragic than the drugs or the drinking was his absolute
disregard
for his own, for like his own body when it came to his voice, because you don't like, anyone can play guitar better. Anyone can play drums better. Anyone can.
You can't get your voice back, though.
Yeah. Once it's gone, it's gone.
It's such a unique instrument.
And if you listen to some of that stuff towards the end of his life, it's still good and it's soulful, and you can still hear the Harry Nilsson in there, but it's not the same. It's no Without You or something like that. Yeah.
I mean, I get goosebumps listening to that stuff. And I mean, sampling the song was a part of a period for me where, like I was saying, that time when I first moved to New York, I was just searching for different types of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know, I want to experiment with this. And I remember being on, I was a little intoxicated, to say the least. And I was with some friends, a friend of mine who's a designer for Calvin Klein, and a photographer friend of mine. And I was on this rooftop in Chinatown, New York, at a party where there was the most bizarre things going on. And I was sitting in a lawn chair on this next to this guy who I don't even remember his name, but he looked like a character out of Fear and Loathing. And this little boombox was sitting next to me, and it was playing all these, you know, really trap hip hop songs, mm-hmm. and things like that. And when trap was really just starting to, you know, get going, and there was people naked doing photo shoots around and all this weird stuff just going down. It was a little weird, but it was, you know, I was just in a state of, like, I was listening to the music, and all of a sudden Harry Nilsson, My Arrow, came on.
Oh, really?
Me and My Arrow. And I was just like, and it was just like the perfect song for the moment, because it was weird and creepy, but fun and lighthearted. It was just, and I was like, I got to sample this and write about this night. And so that's what I did. The song specifically about, you know, being in New York and feeling somewhat lost, but knowing that, you know, in New York, there's this weird thing called the train. So no matter how lost you go, you get, the subways will always, you're always going to get somewhere.
Yeah.
You can always go somewhere, and eventually you're going to find your way back home, you know? So
that's interesting.
Yeah. And then the whole album's about the trains.
I read that like the whole balloon album is about like riding the train.
The balloon guide.
The balloon guide. That's right.
Yeah.
You said it was all about traveling from like borough to borough, neighborhood to neighborhood, stop to stop, and kind of each place kind of having its own thing going for it, its own story. Which I mean, I was able to enjoy the record as just the record beforehand, but then when, mm-hmm. I got that piece of information, that piece of the puzzle right there, I was able to kind of listen to it. I'm like, oh, I see what he's doing right now. These are little snapshots, mm-hmm. almost like little short stories in a collection, mm-hmm. Of just moving along on the line.
Yeah, exactly. And so the album was interesting because I was spending so much time in New York. You spend so much time on the trains.
Oh yeah,
you spend hours of your day on the trains, and a lot of people don't realize that they, you know, if you come to visit New York, you're normally staying in one area, and you might take some trains to go to a baseball game or go to, you know, the Bronx Zoo or some, you know, go uptown or go downtown. But when you live in New York, the trains are a whole city of themselves, yeah. and it's a whole part of your life where you're commuting to and from work or commuting to and from shows or different meeting up with different people. And each neighborhood is so different. Each stop is so different. And the people you see on these things, you get to know, mm-hmm. the trains and the routes. And I was always fascinated with it because my grandfather was a conductor.
On the MTA?
Yeah, for years.
What was his line?
Oh my gosh, what was it? Was it the 5 line? I think he did the 5 line, which is the green line. So I had always been interested by the trains, and, you know, I used to remember being a kid and like riding them and looking down and just being really amazed by the graffiti, which a lot of it's not there anymore. And so when I started the album, I just was working with so many different other artists and producers, and I was like, how am I going to bridge this together? Because everything was coming out so, you know, but I realized everything, because a lot of my writing was being done on the train.
Oh,
so
like going to or from.
Yeah.
Oh, okay,
we'd start a session in, you know, Williamsburg, and then I'd be on the train going home for an hour and a half at 3 a.m. And so, you know, I'd just write different things, and I'd write about what I saw and about where I was, and then I decided to get a recorder.
Oh, just like
a travel recorder.
Like a little, like those little two-track ones.
Like a Tascam.
Ones, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so what I did is I, you know, set up a little, set up the recorder so that it was kind of hidden within my backpack.
Oh, okay.
And I made different, I tried different things out, you know, keeping it in different pockets and holding it in different ways, and just started recording the sounds and the conversations that I heard, and then started doing things like just meeting people, interviewing them on the subway.
Oh, like just like, did they know you were interviewing them? Or?
Sometimes they did.
Okay. So sometimes you just have like the thing in your front pocket and you would just start talking. Did you find that people were like, that people were receptive to that? Because I mean, it's one thing for you and I to be sitting here on mics. This is an established situation.
New York is crazy.
That I've
man.
Invited you into, and we have expectations of what's going on here. But if I was sitting on the train
in New York, there's no expectations. You never know what's going
to
happen.
Yeah,
that's
but I'm curious how I would react to that on a train in New York City. I imagine differently than I would react to it on a train here in Philadelphia or a
different,
train in
yes,
another part
yes.
of the country.
Well, in New York, there's an expectation of craziness.
Yeah,
you just expect weird things to happen when you're, especially on the trains. Somebody's gonna break out and be like, "Showtime!"
Oh yeah,
the kids are gonna start breakdancing.
Yep.
Or somebody's gonna pull out a trumpet and start playing, or you know, or somebody's gonna start doing some poetry, or you know, somebody's gonna start spewing their religious beliefs, or you know, somebody's gonna get in a fight. Or nowadays, you know, I rode the train the other night at 4 a.m. and I'm worried about slashers. You know?
Oh, in New York?
Yeah, that's a big thing.
What is that,
thing.
Like people just cutting people?
Walking by and cutting you.
What the fuck is...
I know, man. It's crazy.
Like,
New
they
York
don't,
is crazy.
They don't take your money or anything like that.
They just cut you.
What
It was big in the 70s.
No, that sounded familiar to me,
razor
too.
Razor blades. So what if you fall asleep on the train, then, you know, it's a big thing.
That's messed up.
And, you know, you never know what you'll see. I've seen somebody masturbating on the trains before. Seen people having sex, you know. It's all crazy.
New
but
York,
I've also
man.
Seen, you know... You know, you see people studying, you see people putting on makeup, you see the conversations you hear that people have are ridiculous. And I was like, this is too crazy. Nobody, you know, nobody's talking about
it. And it all exists in this little underground
Exactly.
thing.
It's like underground city, man.
And for
it's
a
crazy.
While, too, before they put the cell phone transmitter lines down there, it was the only place in the city where nobody could.
Exactly.
Mess with that. I was talking with someone not long ago about that. He was saying like,
and that's a new thing.
Like 2 or 3 years ago, he said, not even
when
even,
I was writing this.
Yeah, he said no one. He says now you get on the train and everyone's got their face in their iPhone. Everyone's got their face in their iPad or whatever.
Uh-huh.
But 2 years ago, people read the paper. People read books. People.
It's one of the few places in America for a long time that you had no connection.
You were just out. You were in transit. You were in limbo
for an hour, 2 hours, for 45 minutes, however long you were on the train.
However long it takes to get uptown or downtown.
Exactly.
And,
you were just there. And that's what made it so interesting. So for me, you know, I'd sit there and write lyrics and hear people talk. People, you know, they get social. People talk to you. They talk to their friends. They talk to random people.
Yeah.
You know, you get to know, sometimes you even get to know certain people.
It's so much more accepted over there, too. Like, a stranger can just start talking, and I will fully admit this, a stranger can just start talking to me in New York City, and I'm down. I'm like, all right, cool. And it's not even because I feel like a tourist, because I've been to New York so many times in my life at this point that it's not home, but I definitely have a handle on it.
Yeah, you understand it.
Yeah, so like if I'm on the subway or I'm like standing out somewhere and someone just starts talking to me or starts talking to my wife, I have a very different reaction to it there than I would pretty much anywhere else. And I get
it's the expectation of crazy. It is. Or different.
Yeah. Because I also feel that New York can be a very cold place and a very bustly place, so that there are times when you get those little moments of human interaction, you don't really have the opportunity to dictate when and where it's going to happen.
Well, New Yorkers aren't afraid of conflict. They're not afraid of conflict or confrontation. They're not afraid of people because they're so used to being around people.
You're never alone.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So this whole, you know, shyness and confident, you know, persona, it just kind of takes, it just takes you over.
Yeah.
It's a whole different world.
I know from an outsider's viewpoint, we can sometimes see that as either indifference or people just don't want to be bothered. But I keep going back in my mind to the idea of you like just straight up interviewing people or just like straight up talking to people on a subway with a recorder.
Yeah, and the stations and different things. And you know, one of the funniest ones was on the end of Roads. The song Roads is the middle song, and so we wrote that kind of in relation to Penn Station.
Yeah.
And it's about, you know, choosing your path. And so at the end of the song, I actually interviewed he's a homeless guy who I had seen a few times just in transit. And I asked him about, you know, I was like, what are you doing? Like, where, why are you here? Like, what are you, you know, he just was like, very honest. I'm trying to get my next drink. So we started talking about drinks. Yeah. So we just, you know, we were like, you know, we, I don't know. It was just, it was something about the conversation. It wasn't like I was talking to, you know, an alcoholic. It was just two guys talking about what kind of drinks they like, what kind of bourbon they like. And, you know, he's like, I like whiskey too. And I'm like, you know, we had that moment of just being able, you know, we didn't go and get a drink, but we probably could have.
You can get a drink down Penn Station now. You can just wander around to one of the places. That's fascinating to me. Like, I like how there's, that's like this whole other layer of the record that that I wasn't really aware of probably the first handful. Like, when you first put the record out and I listened to it, I wasn't aware. I was just aware that these were great songs and that they were cool and they all hung together. I was always aware that they hung together very well. I wasn't probably...
Well, there's emotion to it.
Yeah.
There's a storyline. There's kind of a brief flow to the idea. It's weird, though, because also we did the 15 songs, the full album, only on the website. So there's different opinions because certain people have only heard the abridged version, which is the 10-track version, which is on iTunes.
Okay, because I think the 15-track version is on Spotify right now, if I'm not mistaken.
Is it?
I want to say that I... Hold on one second. Oh, it's only... You know what? It's on your Bandcamp that all 15
Bandcamp,
are on there.
That's
all right, yeah, so I only got to 10. Oh.
It's all good. Well, it's funny because one of the reasons we did that is because we couldn't clear some of the samples.
Oh, okay.
Especially... We had a choice to either put them out or not. There's a section of the album which is very, you know, it's the Harlem Upper West Side section, and I decided to use a lot of African influential tracks for sampling. So it's a lot of this stuff that is really interesting in terms of the sample products, and we were able to flip it and, you know, turn them into hip hop tracks and things, but a lot of diversity in those songs, and we just decided to kind of keep them a little different from from the other part of the album. But actually, that's some of my favorite stuff. A song, Inshallah, which is a Sudanese band that we sampled, and we couldn't get in contact with them through Soundwave Records. And
you couldn't, it wasn't like they refused you or didn't refuse you,
couldn't get it in time.
And it's interesting too with bands like that, you're curious if they're even still
back recently,
or if they're still a band. Are they still a band?
I don't know. They actually emailed us. They emailed us with a pretty generic letter like about 2 or 3 months ago.
Yeah.
The album's been out for 2 years. I was like, I'll let you know about the next thing. You know?
Oh, what, they sent you a letter to be like, please sample us, like, or something.
Well, they
like...
send us a letter like, we need more information, you know.
Gotcha.
Like, here's what we, you know, if you need this. And I was just like,
well. We already did it. So.
Yeah, we didn't sell it.
But we already did it. Yeah, I suppose you could send them.
Gave it away for free.
Yeah, I suppose you could send them a track and see what they think. But it's pretty much already, it's already out there.
Yeah.
At this point, that's interesting. Do you run into that a lot when you're finishing tracks?
It's crazy, man. You know, being a producer in this day and age, I'm so kind of heartbroken by that whole thing, because a lot of the music I love, especially early on in hip hop, is so sample driven.
Well, yeah, exactly.
And it's because of the fact that it's sample driven that makes it unique.
Mm-hmm.
It was that in itself is an art. And
creating a whole lot of different pieces, and that process itself is what you end up in. It's the cliche of the whole being not necessarily the sum of its parts. It's like you take a James Brown cut, mm-hmm. and an Afrika Bambaataa cut, and a John Coltrane line over it, and each three of those things on their own stand and are great, but then you mishmash them together in just the right way that you get this completely different thing that you would never get.
And that's the thing that people don't get, is that it's a different thing.
Mm-hmm.
Just because you take a sound,
yeah,
doesn't mean that, you know, somebody else owns that sound.
Yeah.
At least in my mind, I don't know. I kind of go back and forth on it in different ways. I think on a case by case basis, you kind of have to do that with anything.
I feel like you get tracks sometimes where like the entire, like the best part of the track is clearly someone else's hook.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I mean, if we're going to like parse lines on that, to me, it's like if an artist, and I don't even just mean this for hip hop, because all kinds of people, it seems like anyone can sample now. You don't have to be a hip hop artist or a rapper.
I was talking to one of the lawyers I work with, Paul Rep, and he was saying about, you know, there's a story about Robert Plant had this really amazing snare in a song.
Yeah.
And another producer came up to him and was like, "Where'd you get that snare, Robert?" And he was like, "You want to know where I got it from? I actually stole it from a Beastie Boys track." Right? And so the Beastie Boys, you know, "Where'd you guys get it?" They're like, "Well, we took it from Led Zeppelin." So, I mean, it's like, who really owned it? You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, that kind of stuff happens. And we were on tour a couple of years ago, and we were listening to, this is before the whole NWA biopic came out.
Oh,
we were listening to Straight Outta Compton, man. And that's like one of the greatest albums in hip hop history. I mean, but the way that it's produced is 100%. It's DJs, man. You know, Kool Herc was sitting in a basement and the Cedric Projects, like, just mixing tracks, creating a whole different sound, because that's what people, and that's what is, I think that's been one of the biggest killers of hip hop. You know, the idea, the lost art of the DJ.
Oh, okay. Yeah. The more I think about it now, I mean, my hip-hop experience is the stuff that I love the most is either from the early and mid-90s, mm-hmm. I wasn't even into the gangster stuff at all. I mean, I was definitely aware of the Chronic, and Doggy Style changed my life because it was the first time I ever heard Parliament used in that way, because I was always a big Parliament fan.
Parliament Funkadelic is amazing.
Which I love. It's like, instead of sampling James Brown, they sample Parliament in a way, and mm-hmm. I think that that's...
Mm-hmm.
If you were to like twist my arm behind my back and say which record do I think is better, The Chronic or Doggy Style, I'd probably say Doggy Style.
Yeah.
Just because it sonically speaks to me in a different way.
They created a sound with that stuff.
Yeah. Well, The Chronic created a sound too, but mm-hmm. I just if I had to
Doggy
pick,
Style
you know,
took the sound to another level.
It's like
I agree.
A Beatles and Stones type thing right there, and both are relevant on their own, and it's, you know, it's all about whatever speaks to you a little
more.
Well,
they're also both Dr. Dre. You know, Dr. Dre just. He started something and he finished it, mm-hmm. you know? So, and that was creating a whole genre. I mean, even to this day, when we have band practices, we say, "Oh, give me the Dre, give me the synth line like a Dr. Dre synth line," you know? But really what we're talking about is, give me a Parliament.
Yeah, that like that wobbly bass, blah, blah, blah. And that's what I love about the Kendrick the Kendrick stuff is that he's bringing that. I mean, he is from Compton too, and he's mm-hmm. kind of bringing back that warbly
influence again.
Yeah, that Bernie Worrell synth. And
I'm glad you brought up Kendrick Lamar because I have to say this.
Yeah,
Kendrick Lamar might be when it's all said and done the single greatest. He's another evolution of hip-hop artists.
I think he's another Chuck D or something like
it's,
that.
It's ridiculous. I just listened to the unmastered, the untitled unmastered.
Me too.
Oh,
me too.
Gosh.
The last two cuts on record are just like, I just listened to them, I'm like...
Those are rejects from To Pimp a Butterfly.
I remember getting to the end of that and like hearing the last two, because I listened to it in pieces, and I got to the last two. I remember listening to the last two, and I kind of finished it. I was wandering around, like I was like walking around the city or something like that, and I finished it, and I was like...
His lyrics and his production and his style, his writing.
Yeah. I was just like, where did you even go from there? Like, you know, what do you do after that?
And you know, in hip hop, I think there's a lot of really talented artists out there right now, especially, you know, people talk about the negative sides of it, and there's some crappy stuff out there.
There's crappy really, stuff in rock
really,
music too. There's
really crappy stuff.
There's in all art. There is, I would say, in all art, you're looking at 75% to 85% shit.
Oh like, yeah. Especially nowadays, because it's so easy to make it into
thing.
Put it out.
Yeah, yeah. But even, I mean, I would even say, I wouldn't say that. I would say back in the 90s, it dates us right here, because I mean, I think you're my age, so we came up in about the same time.
Yeah.
I really think that the quality of music in the 80s and 90s, and there was some crap in the 80s and 90s, but there was less of it. Because there was just less stuff, and so
there was
if something
more gatekeeping.
but if something was great and something was truly going to cross genres and cross boundaries, it had more of the opportunity to do so simply because there were just less outlets. And whether that's good or bad is, you know, that's a debate that one
it
could
is a
have.
Debate. And I tend to, you know, as an artist now, I tend to debate that it's better to have the outlets.
Yeah,
I just think there needs to be some control.
I think
in terms
people
of,
need to curate better.
Exactly. And I think money changed. Money is the real enemy when it comes to that. It's just because something sells doesn't make it good.
That's funny, too, because there was more money back then in some way. Well, pop music is always an overinflated part of money. But at least in the rock world and sort of the mid-underground regional world, there was so much more money in the 90s for that now than there is now.
I don't know about that, because I think that now the money's spread out to the full scope of the art. versus yeah. just the music. So an artist can come out, not make good music, but have a good look or a good, you know, a good Twitter handle. or
That's true.
Something, you know, they could be really good at making videos.
Yeah, they can make really awesome videos. They could be very visually presentable.
Exactly. Like, the biggest thing is just, I think there's a lot of artists out there who, and I was saying this about the idea of sampling, killing hip-hop. I think there's a lot of artists out there who don't understand the aspect of art. I don't think they grasp what making and creating something artistically means, because they're so concerned with the way it's consumed.
They're so concerned in how people are going to take it and how people are going to digest it and then what they're going to get out of that you lose the process of, well, you got to make something worthwhile to begin
with. People like this. This is what we do. You know, this is what I do. This is my, you know, this is my aesthetic. This is, you know, I'm just being me or, you know, and all those things are
not,
great.
But usually
try being
not.
Better.
Yeah.
Like
try improving. Yeah. Try trying some shit you've never done before.
Yeah, try doing something that's different or something that, you know, that is unique to you.
Mm-hmm.
But also understanding that there is a science to certain aspects. You know, music is based on numbers and projections and things like that, and it's how you flip it and you know, there is a science. You know, not everything can be abstract art. You know,
it's true. Not everything's gonna be abstract, but then not everything's gonna get spelled out and laid out for you right there, like
exactly.
a pop track. And it's all about, as I've always, I mean, I've said this for years, is that like sometimes you get dessert, and sometimes you got to eat your vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think sometimes you get dessert, sometimes you get Adele, who's great. I love Adele,
and I think that pop music actually, I think pop music is the best that it's ever been. I think there's more, like, it goes back to that thing about more, but I think the pop, like, real pop music that's coming out, like you mentioned Adele or, I don't know if you're familiar with the young girl, Alicia Cara.
No, I'm not.
Her song Hair is amazing, and I don't know if she wrote it, but I think she did.
Yeah.
And it sounds like she did.
Or I think of someone like what's her name, Carsey Blanton or something like that with her single right now, and I think that's a phenomenal single, and I think it's a great kind of genre spanning thing right
Even
there.
Meghan Trainor, I thought that was a great song.
Yeah.
Very, very.
To a point, and then I did never wanted to hear it.
Well, yeah, anything that gets played that much is going to.
Yeah.
But, you know, I hate to say this, but Justin Bieber's new music is really good.
I have to say, I don't think I've ever heard a Justin Bieber song, and I'm not saying that to be cool.
I just don't
know if I ever have. Like, I have a whole joke that I have with people at work about how I didn't know what Hotline Bling sounded like for the first 6 months it existed.
You
want to
know
what
Hotline Bling sounds like?
What?
Timmy Thomas. why can't we?
Why can't we be friends?
Yeah.
Oh, I just, when I finally heard it the first time. No, I mean, I probably heard it like 5 times before, but then something clicked in there. I'm like, oh, this is that song.
Wait, it's not like, I'm trying to remember the name of the Timmy Thomas song now. I'm sorry, I just totally blanked out on you.
Yeah, I was able to recognize Hotline Bling more from other people's either spoofs or interpretations of Hotline Bling.
Uh-huh.
And then by the time I finally got to Hotline Bling, I'm like, oh, okay.
Drake's the ultimate culprit to me of just a pop. And we have to give a lot of credit to the engineers and the producers working on this music.
Definitely.
Because they're the real artists, you know? They're the ones. I mean, there's such an art to the sonic quality of music, and that's one of the things that I've put a lot of time into. And the Balloon God, we really focused on that. You know, we really modeled that album after Kendrick's Mad Kid, or Good Kid, Mad City, the Macklemore album, The Heist, and also the Drake album. And we wanted to sonically sound, you know, in comparison to those artists, because it's such, you know, we live in an HD world.
Yeah.
We live in a world where people don't want to hear things that don't sound crisp and clean.
Yeah.
Or sound, you know, they want a certain quality of sound. Even if it is ran tape or, you know, or vinyl and things like that, they want it to sound clear and understand, and they want the detail. And, you know, that's such an art form that is lost in so many, with computers and technology. It's, you know, you talk about artists putting out bad music. They put out bad music. A lot of times it's just bad, because the worst thing to me is artists who put out good music and it just sounds bad.
Yeah.
So I think that's something that a lot of artists and need to really start to open their eyes to. I'm really lucky because I work with some great engineers, Dave Humes, who runs the studio that we work out of here, and also my guy George Cassius Cylon. Mm-hmm. He's our engineer, and he's mixed our stuff to really he started, you know, we start with him on the ground floor. So that's the whole concept, the idea of getting things together to sound great.
This is a whole nother level of collaboration right there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We have a whole system, you know. It goes from the recording to the mixing to the mastering. And, you know, we've used Peter Humphreys for the Balloon Guide and, mm-hmm. and different things. And JR, Jeff Ryan Audio in New York. And so, you know, we're specifically going into studios like this is the equipment we have to use because this is the standard of our sound.
Yeah.
And so I think that's an important thing that a lot of artists fall on.
I think it's very important to, there's so many facets that you have to juggle, and in any style of art, be it music or painting or writing or mm-hmm. what have you, is that you have to have an idea, you need to refine that idea, and then you need to present that idea in an idealized form. And there are arguments to make back and forth about what that idealized form is. I myself love very high-end production. I'm a big Steely Dan fan, and yeah. I love a lot of the stuff from the 70s and 80s that sounds like that. But then I also, you know, I also love the first two White Stripes albums, and those are some pretty gritty sounding records. Even the first Led Zeppelin record is...
But the grittiness isn't the bad thing. It's because it gives you a feeling.
Yeah. And there was no laziness there. That was intentional. Whether through circumstances of economics or availability, but they said, if it's going to sound gritty, if...
We want it to sound good.
Yeah, if we're running a 2-inch tape, then we're not going to play... We're not going to worry about a whole bunch of MIDI parts. We're just going to have, you know, guitars and drums.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, it's you have to make those. It's about making decisions in the studio.
And educating yourself. You have to do research. You know? Yeah. That's where artists, I think, fall short. Everybody wants to go in the studio and just make and create.
Well, I think
create.
It's going to just be lightning in a bottle. You think you're just going to walk in the studio, get an idea, and boom, it will just literally fall from your face onto the paper and just be like, and there it is. And like that is not how it happens. Just even listening to the Kendrick stuff. Oh, you're talking about the Kendrick stuff. That stuff that he didn't even deem worthy of putting out mm-hmm. on the record. And that stuff sounds great. So, you know, you need to have a level of curation. You need to be a self-editor, or at least have people around you who are going to edit for you.
In hip-hop, one of the things that really bothers me is artists that come into the studio. And, producing, I work with a lot of different artists.
Mm-hmm.
Artists who come to the studio and just think they can hop in the sound booth and just
hit it.
Freestyle.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes you can, and that's the goal, is to be able to go in there and keep it natural.
Yeah.
But you should go in there
with a plan.
With a plan, exactly. Some thought process behind it. And kind of understanding. And the ideal thing is, you know, when you hear about Jay-Z and people like that doing it, they're not going into the studio and taking it on one take. They're sitting in the studio and working on the song for hours.
Yeah.
And then go and they have the luxury of being in the studio where they don't have to write things down, because they can be like, oh, did we get that? They can piece it together, and then mm-hmm. he can practice it a few times, or whatever. However, this, you know, he does it. So,
But you don't need a major studio to do that. You can do that in your house now.
You need to, you know. And one of the main reasons I came back to Philly is to be in the studio more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in New York, we wound up running all the time. We're always at events and always at. Yeah. I was like, I just need to simplify my life and get back in the studio, man.
Yeah,
that's really what it is. I'm still in New York running. I just do it less days. I'm there, you know, 2-3 days a week instead of
all seven. Yeah.
Or now I'm there less. I'm there significantly less now because I don't be there.
Well, and I think it also helps you focus when you're up in New York. That when you're up there in New York, you very much are focusing on what you're doing. And
performance,
and then
networking.
You come home,
and then I'll come home, and I'm in the studio, and I'm in my happy place.
Which is to me it's one of the reasons I think that brought me to Philadelphia a dozen years ago, was that I loved New York and
this
I loved being able to do what I needed to do. But also I wanted some place to go where I can just like, and we're turning that off right now. Cause I think if I lived in New York, I'd lose my mind. I'd never be able to turn off.
It happens.
That's why I never went to college up there, even though I wanted to. I knew myself well enough where I was just like, I'm going to lose my mind there because there's too much going on and I'm going to be trying to do all of it.
I mean, you can leave the bar at 4 a.m. and walk right into a diner and start drinking, you know. That's New York for you. It happens more than I'd like to admit.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
So what are you
days?
So what are you working on now?
So right now, you know, we're in the studio.
You got the live band together, and that seems to be gelling.
Yeah, the band is a part of the larger project right now, which is loosely based around the new label, Balloon Up Media, and kind of all the work I do. We wanted to do an extension of the Balloon Guide, and one of the things I really loved about those sessions when we were doing it, you know, we had a specific place we were working out of, and we were there consistently, and we just brought in different people all the time, you know, different vocalists, different...
Yeah, there's a lot of vocalists on that record.
Different vocalists, different producers, different musicians. Yeah. And I said, you know what? That's what I want. I just want to have a studio space, where a creative space where we can just work with different artists, and no matter who's doing it, they can come in. So I kind of took some time off last year to do a lot more research in terms of what I was doing and to decide what was the best decision for me, and that's part of the reason why I'm back here. But the larger scale project is something that I'm calling Art House 95 as of now, and it's kind of a collective. Not a collective in any sort of who's in it, but a collective around the concept of what we want to do musically. So we have a specific sound that we're going for, a specific style, a specific process. And, you know, every time that we do it, we make it different in the aspect of that moment. It's a lot of different ideas being put out where I'm particularly trying to be much more honest. And part of being honest is about talking about what I feel and not giving a damn, you know, like about what I say or how people are going to take it. And right now, the biggest thing to me is some of the things that I think that this world and the artists in it aren't talking about. So whether that's politics or social issues or just the concepts, there's, you know, there's, I watched last week's night, and sometimes I'll just, you know, listen to John Oliver, mm-hmm. and I'll get an idea from a verse, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm like, this is something I don't know. Special governments.
I watched that today, too, when I got home from work about the special districts.
Yeah.
And I was just like...
I'm like, ghost governments?
Ghost government.
I'm like, and that's something, you know, that's like, these are real things that nobody's talking about, and especially not in music. I mean, there's 900 songs right now that I can name that are about love that came out in the last year.
Yeah.
There's, you know, sex, and there's drugs, and there's rock and roll.
Yeah, but very little partying. Is about social issues. Very little is about...
And when they are about social issues, a lot of times they're about the same stuff.
Yeah, or they're just kind of they're just sort of paying lip service to it. Or you get a guy like D'Angelo who makes a record that's almost entirely about it.
Yeah, you know, it's not... We just need to be more honest and talk about these things, you know, like... I just wrote a verse on a song I'm doing with Fishtown Beats. And the verse is just, it's a 16-bar verse where it's a story. You know, it's he had this really jazzy sample, gave it to me. And I wrote the song in about, you know, maybe a half hour and went in and recorded it. But the verse specifically touches on things like Black Lives Matter, you know, Bernie Sanders versus Hillary Clinton. It touches on the ideas of... that we have as Western civilization about what we find important. It talks about there's little hints to Occupy Wall Street. But the verse isn't about any of that stuff. It's about a guy meeting a girl in a coffee shop, and they have a conversation.
Oh, interesting.
And, you know, his perception of her and her perception and how they just communicate and form a quick friendship. So it's not talking about the girl in terms of, oh, I like her, you know, I like her ass.
Yeah.
It's talking about, you know, we had... You know, I should probably just spit the verse, but I'm not gonna do that right now because I'm gonna save it for Fishtown's album.
Gotcha.
But you know,
no, but that's a really interesting idea, and that's social issues right there, and that's dealing with women in hip hop in a way, dealing with women as subject matter in hip hop in a way that doesn't necessarily always get dealt with. I'm not saying no one else does it, but you know, it's not necessary.
No.
It's not necessarily the first place it seems to go. And in rock music too. I don't even want to put that all on hip hop. And in
it's our
all music in general.
Well, it's our society, man.
Well, yeah.
You know, I remember that the guy, I don't remember his name, and I don't want to even publicize him, but there was a situation about a year and a half, 2 years ago, where there was a young man in college in California who wound up killing a bunch of people, mostly women, because in his video blog, he stated that he was, you know, he had some mental issues, but he stated that he was not happy because the women didn't show him the proper amount of attention.
Yeah.
And they didn't follow. And I, you know, it was such a depiction of our society.
Yeah.
Of how we, as men, you know, we're two guys sitting here.
Yeah.
But realistically, we're taught certain things growing up as men, and the world teaches society so many things about the gender roles and what it means to be a man and how women are supposed to treat you and how you're supposed to approach
what you should
them.
Expect.
Exactly, the expectations of sexes. And when I saw that, and it was disgusting to me because I realized for the first time
too,
in my life, I realized, and I was just like, for the first time in my life, I realized that some of these things are things that I thought are done.
Well, yeah, you know, those are some
like, not when, knowingly.
Whenever I hear that, or when I hear like men's rights activist guys spouting off on the internet, because God forbid they would ever do it out loud to real people. But and I look at that, and I was just like, I can't even fathom where you would like just how you could continue to go through life and expect that this style, that this behavior and this mindset is okay. And I like to think of myself as someone who can, you know, look at the other side politically and at least get where they're coming from, be it through fear or poverty or whatever, or to look at, just to look at all kinds of other things and be like, I don't agree, but I see where that came from. When I hear that stuff, I'm just like, I don't understand how you can walk through life and think you're the good guy on this, because no one ever thinks of themselves. No one's the bad guy.
No one's ever the bad guy, they're not necessarily the bad guy. And you know what? It took me to realize, as a black man, my whole life has been, in a large part, the side conversation has always been race to me. You know, and so when I thought about it, I was like, well, you know, the sexist society that we live in, it's so taboo to accuse a man of these things. You know, even when we hear things about like different rape trials or sexual harassment, or even just the way that
even just like men, a guy hollering at a girl on the street or something like that.
And we joke about it. And the way, you know, I was sitting with a friend and the friend said something about Amy Schumer or whatever her name is, and said something about her weight. And I was like, well, you know, like me and another, we were just like, well, would we say this if she was a guy? You know, would it even matter? Those type of things.
There's
we need
plenty
to check
of plus
ourselves.
Size male male comedians that we don't say anything about.
We need to check ourselves a lot of times, I think, and it's one of the things that gets overlooked. And as a black man, you know, I know that the race thing is still very alive and very real. And, but let's step back from even that just for a quick second and acknowledge the fact of the other plights that people have, whether it's religion, sex, sexual orientation.
Yep.
You know, these are struggles that are very real, and if you don't agree with them sometimes, it doesn't necessarily make you a bad person, but you need to understand that that's not necessarily how everybody feels.
Well,
we all come from a woman. Like,
well, but even if... I used to say that all the time. I used to say, like, you know, we all have moms, a lot of us have sisters, wives, girlfriends, cousins, aunts, blah, 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 grandmothers. But in the end, it's something I realized recently. I was just like,
person.
But even if none of that was true,
still another person.
You still don't act like that. It doesn't matter that I came from a woman or that I'm married to a woman. It's that even if none of that was true, even if that was not the factor that we all shared in common, you still don't act like that.
Yeah, and I say, you know, we came from women, just meaning that there's a synergy in life of balance.
Definitely.
You know, and so
coexistence,
all that stuff. So you come from a man and a woman, and even if your family, your nuclear family isn't that, you know, even if you have two fathers or two mothers, whatever it is, the respect of balance, there wouldn't be one without the other.
Exactly.
I ask myself this question a lot of times, and I'm just like, what are you doing? Like, just, you know, like, and I find musically that works really well too.
Yeah. You know? Oh, just ask yourself, what are you doing?
What are you doing? Why are you doing this? You know,
and if you can answer the question with a good answer,
check yourself.
Then you're just like, okay, carry on. Well, that's great. Well, Marcus, thank you so much for coming in and sitting and talking.
I appreciate it, man. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm glad to be able to catch up with you.
Oh,
This is beautiful. This is a beautiful moment, and hopefully we'll do this again, and we'll get some things rolling, man.
Definitely.
Got to get you some music.
Definitely,
some of the new music coming out.
I want to hear the new stuff. I'm excited.
I'm excited too, man.
All right, thanks. Man. Thanks. Well, that's the show for this week. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for checking it out, for downloading it, for streaming it, for, I don't know, listening to your office mate's cubicle while they're listening to the show. Hey, I'm glad you came too. Thanks to Marcus Harris for being on the show. It was great. It was great to talk to Marcus. Like I said, I've known him a bit over the years, but it was great to really sit down and have an in-depth conversation with him and just really find out where he's from, what he's about, all that. I love doing that with people on this show. I love kind of getting to know people that I have, you know, sort of a passing acquaintance with. I like getting to know them better here on the show. Go to mhtheverb.com. Get to know Marcus better there, too. He's got all his releases up there, and there's quite a few of them, more than just The Balloon Guide, which was the record that we talked about. All kinds of other stuff is on there, so you're going to want to check that out. All his tour dates, too. He DJs a lot all over Philly and New York City, Brooklyn, places like that. So check out mhtheverb.com for all that info. Check out Marcus, constantly searching artist, a dude constantly looking to work with other people and, you know, step out of his artistic comfort zone and just try some stuff. I salute that. I respect that. Go to 25oclockpod.com, too. I salute and respect the things on that site, too. Anyway, that's the show for this week. I want to give a quick shout-out to everyone going to the Planned Parenthood benefit on Friday, March 18th at the First Unitarian Church here in Philadelphia. It's an all-female punk band lineup. All the money goes to Planned Parenthood. I'm excited to go. Tickets have been sold out for a couple of months, but I'm pretty sure there are still people getting rid of them online. You might be able to find one. It's going to be awesome, so if you know me and know what I look like, you can come. High five. We can celebrate being in the sweaty, loud basement of the First Unitarian Church. So I'm really looking forward to that. That's Friday, March 18th here in Philadelphia. Anyway, that's the show. We're going to go now, but we're going to go out on a track from Marcus. This is a track from his record, The Balloon Guide, which was the record we talked about on the show. It's a song called Flags. Features Koofnauts. It's a great track. You're going to hear it here on 25 O'Clock. My name is Dan Drago. Take care of yourselves.
Okay, I pledge allegiance, still fighting for freedom. Every step I move closer, so I'm constantly reaching.
Breathing life into the cause.
Good intention, ignore laws unless they're universal.
Work to strengthen the circle.
The ignorance will hurt you if you open them floodgates. Instead, I meditate on how to change our old ways. Still a king rocking crowns and gold chains. Prayer for the streets all covered in bloodstains. Old souls, young souls lost in the gunplay. Wave the flag, wave the white flag. They waving rags, running wild, even toes tag. I'm throwing words into action. Gather the fractions, an army of passion to free those captured. Run or resist, stand up or surrender. Damn, a double-edged sword, just want a peaceful ending. No mass pretending, the flag's in plain sight. One black, one white. Both are key to igniting our flight. Lose their ego, but fight for good reason. My flag's way heavy and waving every season. Lose the ego, but fight for good reason. My flag's way heavy and waving every season.
Do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags, boy?
What mean the word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean the word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean the word to you? Won't never mean a word to me.
I put my flags up in the sky from world to sea.
Yeah, they hate that I'm a leader. They try to take my visa, but I'm on top of the world. Standing next to Giza.
I got an army of blog readers wearing both shoes and white beaters. Sitting outside my crib, it's like Rise of the Machine.
Damn, she got me rising in my jeans.
Yeah, balloon up, that's my team.
Uh-huh, his art show is my scene. All I need is some Chardonnay, cause I already got that green.
So bring your flask and a bubbler, a wine glass and some rubbers. Bitch, don't kill my vibe, if she asking then I love her. But I only show love those that stand behind my back. The ones that stand up with my motherfucking flag.
Rise the morning sun about 5 minutes late.
wash my face so I can start with a clean slate. Scrub and scrub until my hands turn glossy. No matter how hard I rub, can't get the black off me. Damn, I'm just a man or a boy, you could say. Like a little kid waking up early on Saturday, armed with a backpack, I hit the streets, plant my flag in the ground. It goes so deep.
Do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags?
What? What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me.
I put my flags up in the sky for
lately, I've been feeling crazy cold. Pay these roads, but no one was meant to pay these tolls. Maybe so, well, some would say that's the way you go. I'm saying no, cause some of us giving 84 to make it show. The difference is what I know, the others just didn't ask it. Stalking what was before, for nothing couldn't get past it. Money hungry's a no, I love it because the passion's running all through my soul. So what that does is a habit, yeah. Mathematics, regardless what the package, you can add it or subtract it, but you can't reenact it. But look, don't get it backwards or misconstrue it, cause this is just for music. No particular image or gimmicks is included. It's important that you understand the underhanded purpose of the verses, what it's worth below the surface. If you're searching, then you can find it. That's if your vision clear. It's been a long haul, long, but we're getting there, yeah.
Do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags?
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 Tell me, do you see them flags?
What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me. What mean a word to you? Won't never mean a word to me.
I put my flags up in the sky for the world to see. For the world to see.